So, thanks for joining me, Tom. It's I've I
My
re,
pleasure.
I've been a fan of your work for a while for all the stuff you've done with Gibson, and I remember your name prior to the Murphy Lab. So it's going to be a lot of fun actually having this conversation.
Sure. Anyone who knows me knows I'd love to talk about first the guitars and especially now the Murphy Lab, for
Excellent.
sure.
Well, that's good for me. Now, I've got my webcam sort of sitting somewhere above, so I'm looking at you. I'm looking at nothing here, and then I'm looking at you here. So if you see my head, you're up
Okay,
and down.
I know how it goes. Yes,
Awesome.
we're
So
in our conference room. My desk, I have a monitor and microphones, but the camera that works is to my right. So if I do one there, I'm always looking off in the distance. So anyway, hopefully this will be a little better.
I'm sure it will be. I'm sure it will be. So my plan, more than anything else, is just to learn a little bit about the Murphy Lab and the aging of these fantastic guitars, and just about your own kind of practices, any bits you might feel like talking to us about on that one, and particular favorite Gibsons. Oh, just that it's more of a conversation than anything else, as I suppose, given that a lot of people will know about yourself and about the Murphy Lab, but for those who don't, I was thinking it might be a nice little kind of introduction to do a brief backstory about how you got involved with this quite niche part of the development of these beautiful guitars. But how did you get to be the guy who is the Tom Murphy aging specialist?
Well, I mean, I feel very fortunate. I've watched my path along the way, and at certain times, I was wondering how I got here, and then now it's actually plain to see. Maybe I'll write a book sometime, but my love of vintage guitar started actually in the 60s, really, and continued through the 70s into my 20s, and the effect that guitars had on people, and we all were affected by the same one. Typical, the Les Paul, somebody play a Les Paul, and somebody play a Strat, and somebody play a Telecaster, and then you just wanted to be around all of this stuff. And as I acquired some of these instruments, I would also admire the finish, especially. And then I got knowledge of how the cracks and stuff and the wear happened. I would watch it on my personal guitars. And I never planned to be a luthier or a technician, really. I was a musician, but with an intense love and appreciation of the subtleties of the guitars and especially the finish. And I got a job at Gibson in the late 80s. And the very first day at work, I knew there were a few people had come from Kalamazoo. And this one older gentleman was walking by my area the first day. And I stopped him and introduced myself and said, do you know how they did the TV yellow finish? He actually was running the parts department. But I thought I could ask this guy that, because I mean, everybody's been intrigued by the TV yellow. And so within a year and a half in a position I was moved to, I figured it out for myself. And then we sort of added it to the mix. And so I'm sure I had a reputation of being really sort of crazy nutty about all these details on the guitar. So, and I loved being around it all, every aspect of the production. Well, then I was invited to a meeting, and that became talk of the historic reissue changes. And then I got to be involved in that through 92 into 93. And that was a really proud moment of my involvement with Gibson. And then the historic division opened in 93, 94. And I was painting tons of guitars, and I left the company, and a lot of people know that, in late 94. Well, I started my own little restoration shop, and with that came a lot of reissues for me to repaint the tops and a restoration of vintage guitars. Well, along with that came, I observed when I'd repair a neck that didn't match the body. We'd all seen that forever, or a glaring repair of a vintage guitar. And I had a 1955 Les Paul Junior that I dropped playing a gig, and it put a dent in the back of the neck. Well, I spent a year trying to repair that area, not very successful, but I finally got it colored and lacquered. And here was this shiny spot right in the middle of the neck. And I literally cut the checks with a razor blade because I was able to do that small area. Well, that led to somebody wanting me to do a whole neck and then a whole guitar. And in 1997, I did a whole reissue guitar with the razor blade check, checking the age of the hardware. I know a real strategy. I just wanted to show it and execute it. That became the aging of a reissue Les Paul. And it blew up to where Gibson called me and said, let's do it together. And so we teamed up. And so in 99, then you could actually buy an aged reissue. And we just sort of waded off into that territory. And that lasted 20 years. And frankly, I was sort of really getting tired of doing it when a new process came to me virtually out of the sky, and it changed everything. And as I told the person that I was involved with, I said, this is a game changer. And I said, it's the future of aging the historic instruments. So that's what we have today. And how that's framed is the Murphy Lab. So the lab is literally a room, and it's literally a concept of aging guitars, and it's literally the product. Some of them hang here behind me. Now, when you see that, that's the Murphy Lab. So as you probably know, there was a demand for Murphy aging over the years, specifically Murphy aging. So initially we got questions, is Tom still doing the aging? And I have responded a couple of times when guys were observing the product and said, do you like it? And you go, it's awesome. Did you do it? And I go, do you like it? Yes. Okay, no more questions. It's the Murphy Lab, okay? I'm not trying to hide anything. It's just that Tom Murphy does not have to execute every detail of every guitar anymore. And so we've been very successful. No compromise of the product is extremely more advanced than anything I could ever do by hand, you know? So it's been an evolution. There was not, and it wasn't a major, any kind of engineering strategy like Gibson said, hey, we want you to do this. I took it to them when they were wanting me to be more closely involved. And so together they supported it wholeheartedly, and it became the lab. And so now my job is to keep it going, inspect the product, be involved with the product. And so, yeah, I mean, it's the Murphy Lab. It's my lab, and the product is mine, and I'm super, super proud of it. I just don't want people to be skeptical, like, okay, so you're not doing it. Look at the product, it speaks for itself. So here we are. Yeah. So that's the evolution of how I got involved with the lab.
Excellent. Excellent. No, that's brilliant. That actually I probably answered loads of questions I have on my little sheet that I've typed out today. But we'll go back to, I wonder, you spoke about a new process, and I'm sure we can talk a little bit about that in a second, but prior to the new process, for the sake of, like, we all have a lot of imaginations about what is entailed. I mean, for example, for the people that are watching at home, all of the guitars behind me are all Murphy Lab Gibsons, and I've got this particular Kindred Burst 59 Les Paul right here, and it's an absolute masterpiece. This will be part of the new process. Prior to you, to the new process existing, what kind of techniques did you, and what I'm interested in about the experimentation in the early days? I mean, you just mentioned about the razor checking to get the check. I mean, that's incredible. That you literally hand all these little lines you were just doing with a razor on top of the finish.
Yeah, I mean, when I started doing that, people would look and go, okay, that's not possible. And I just was put in a position and had the ability to execute it. And like I said, it wasn't a major strategy. Like, I'm going to do this and I'm going to charge a lot of money for it. And no, I was just... I saw it as my next step of involvement with the historic guitars. Because I'm very, very personally close to the historic itself, starting in 93. I took that guitar myself to Anaheim for Gibson, put it on a stand, and my peers went, wow, you know, the changes we had made on instruments. And that instrument exists today, even more refined. I mean, the guitar is so awesome today in terms of authenticity. I've told this, if you look at a guitar after 2019, the logo itself, the Gibson logo, was discovered to have sort of a flat area on the top of the G in the Pearl logo. It's now rounded like a 50, logo. And when I heard that, I thought, really? That's sort of overkill. But it's necessary now. When I see the flat one, I don't like it. I like our current logo. But that's how far we've come in terms of capturing the design and spirit of the 50s instruments. They're beautiful. And the most subtle little thing, the new switch tip is just killer. Well, aging falls right into the next phase of how can we make these have the spirit of vintage look and feel. And so when I started with razor blade, I never dreamed I would do a whole guitar. I did repair in small areas and was able to capture the look. But all of a sudden when I did a whole guitar, I sort of screwed up and showed that I could do it. And there was a demand for it. And I really love those that time and the guitars. And I love that I was able to please people with the look. But if you can imagine what I saw when I would do the guitars every day for years, I wanted them to look good, every single piece. But the whole time I think, if I could just find a way to do a more authentic look and execute what I knew to be the real way that get the guitars finished, cracked, and relaxed. And I'm telling you, that's what I feel on the Murphy Lab instruments. I have a new thing. I say that I used to take a new guitar with a new finish and try to make it look old, and now I think we virtually take a new guitar and put an old finish on it. It's almost that simple. Sure. And so that's what I'm most excited about, because it's not artificial. It's really capturing the feel and look of an old finish.
We sell these guitars on Guitar, and people can go click and see them all. I've been lucky enough through the years that I've worked with the company to have my hands on actual examples of vintage Gibson Les Pauls and so on. And we were uncasing these today, and it's uncanny. It's indistinguishable. The detail there's a level of accuracy that I probably most people don't expect. And I don't know if your team have found this, but it's difficult to photograph the checking doesn't show up as in the photos. It looks so much better when you just get it's so realistic.
I know. I realize now why I stared at guitars over the years and just would be mesmerized and wonder, how did that happen? What makes this happen? I lived in Colorado for about 10 years, and I had played a gig, and we were snowed in for the night after the gig. And so the next day drove to my town and had left my gold top Les Paul in the van overnight in a blizzard, went into my apartment, opened the case, and the entire finish shattered before my eyes. I heard it and saw it, and I was really bummed out. It's like, oh, wow. I didn't know I was going to do that for a living someday, but I saw it happen. It was really, really, really cold, and I opened the case. So a lot of times people are warned in those conditions, don't open your case as soon as you get your guitar. But so just to let you know that I was didn't realize that's what happens. Wood expands and contracts all the time. And virtually forever based on humidity, temperature, and brittle lacquer will not, it's not flexible. So it won't tolerate the slightest movement. So anyway, I'll just say that without talking about our process,
sure.
I'll just say that the checking is real. We do have a process to execute that. And literally every day I inspect guitars and hold them up and go, wow. I mean, it's Mother Nature doing it. And every piece is unique. A lot of models are very similar. The SGs happen to generally check around horizontally around the body and neck, and the Firebirds do the same thing. I was blown away when I did my first ES guitar when it checked vertically up and down the face, because that's plywood and it happens to respond differently. That was really, really exciting.
Oh, yeah, because you wouldn't have expected that. You were kind of expecting to see the same thing happen.
Wow. No, I was just, I knew they would crack.
Sure.
But to, for them to perform and like real pieces do was super exciting, because that way virtually all the guitars have their own characteristic. And because I have some Les Pauls, I mean, they check so perfectly.
Mm.
And I don't see it happen, but I see the result. But it's really cool. And the one thing I've done a lot of interviews, of course, and discussion about it. But the one thing I told marketing one time is, let's don't hype this like that we got to convince people that it's cool. All they have to do is see it and realize when I say that's real checking, that's all you need to know. Then your guitar, you can take it, play it, and feel it, and hear it, and see for yourself if it has any effect. We don't claim sonic benefits, but trust me, these guitars feel and sound killer.
Oh yeah, big time, big time. So yeah, I wonder, like, when you were, so there's a process now, and of course, if I venture into the territory of asking questions that are secrets, yeah, then yeah, we just dodge sure it back. But what I'm wondering is, in the earlier days, like back in the days of the razor checking and everything, were there any experiments that you tried to sort of like to age guitars that were really, really unsuccessful, that were really, that if things went wrong?
Well, I did have some moderate success with trying to get a guitar really cold and hot. I did a body one time, and I thought, if I bake this and make the solvents out of it, because it you don't have to be a paint expert to know that there are solvents, liquid, and then there's color, and there's things that make the finish, the lacquer. Well, if those evaporate over time, that's why it gets brittle, of course.
Mm.
And so I baked it. Well, at lunchtime, I took a guitar body home and put it in the oven to exaggerate, to speed up the process. And I was making a sandwich in turn, and it was on fire in the oven. That was one experiment that went horribly wrong. And so I thought, no, I don't think that's a really good process. But that was me attempting to think what I thought would speed up the aging process of a finish. Mm. And yeah, maybe, but I abandoned that right away. But I will say this, that we do have a proprietary finish ourselves in the lab, exclusively through the lab. In the custom shop here, we produce guitars every day. The Murphy Lab guitars have tape on them, which specifies our finish goes on that on the guitar. It's not the finish that goes on the rest of the product.
Ah, that's interesting. Oh, yeah. That's something I was really wanting to ask about. So is that what my question was going to be, was do the Gibson Custom Shop sort of, I don't mean prepare, but is there something different about the ones that are destined for your lab compared to the ones that don't get the treatment? And that would be a part of that then.
Yeah, precisely. And in fact, if a guitar, based on information on a specification sheet at one department where they put tape on the fingerboard to keep the paint off, of course, if they put our tape on, which is a certain color, then it automatically gets our finish all the way through. If it's found that that guitar was not supposed to go to the lab, it cannot go out to the public with our finish on it, because we can't trust it to be stable and not checked, because it's bound to probably check at some point, sure, which would be the worst thing for a lot of people, but we have to control that. So the Murphy Lab has an exclusive finish on it, of course.
Right. Okay. Yeah, because I wondered, obviously, the last few decades, lots and lots of companies have tried their hand at aging guitars, sure, and doing relic work and so on. And it seems quite clear that polyurethane finishes, your standard kind of hard finish, is not the best for it. And the nitrocellulose-based stuff, which is what Gibson historically use, and other companies, that seems to be more naturally beautiful when you do the relic work to it, the aging work to it. So would does that mean that like a custom shop Gibson normally gets a nitro finish, but it's a top nitro lab one, it's going to be different entirely?
Right. It's formulated specifically to come to the lab and to be checked. Okay. Yeah. And but it's not a great finish if you do not want your car to take on aging. No, you don't want this. So it's very unique that we have a very specific need and use for it, but it's not practical for a guitar finish in general. I love the way it feels and lets the guitar feel and vibrate and so on. Those are benefits to myself and people that feel like they do about the guitar in general. I don't mind if my guitar has cracks or chips or whatever. But in terms of durability, and what finishes are more normally formulated to do is to protect the guitar, its color and the wood and so on. And so polyurethane is great. It's just really, really hard and virtually indestructible, but it tends to have maybe a little stigma of not being organic and natural like nitro.
One thing I wondered about with you've got the all of Gibson's classic models available to some regard. Is there a particular favorite that you have anyway, just as a guitarist? And then is there one that you think you particularly enjoy working on over another type?
Well, obviously the Sunburst Les Paul in general, because that's the king. I love the results that we get on them, but I love to see, as I said. I love to see an SG with beautiful horizontal, beautiful checking and looping of the checks. When I see that, I'm just glad to be part of it for the consumer. And so I like all of them. And the ES is when we get a killer result of really, really authentic checking. You just can't beat it. And so all of a sudden the guitar takes on a whole nother kind of a personality. Guitars don't have to be beat up. You know, we have four levels of aging, and I help engineer that. It's like, okay, we will give the consumer a choice. You have all weather checking, lightly aged hardware, no chips, no dings, no scratches, out of the box. Okay, or you can have now some sign of it being played. That's our light category. Then we get into the heavy age, which is now not only has been played, there's some belt buckle wear on the back, arm wear starting to happen on the front. And it just progresses to the ultra heavy, which is radically aged, distressed look. And we do all of them every day because they're our taste. People have... one of the very first orders for the lab was 18 Les Pauls painted by me, ultra heavy age. And we hadn't even shipped any guitars. I asked our salesman, has the dealer seen ultra heavy age? Because, you know, that's like really, really heavily beat up and worn. Does he realize that? And I thought, maybe he just thinks it's the coolest. So that's the one he wants. Ultra heavy. But of course, now people are getting informed and experiencing the instruments. And I really like our light aging because it's very comfortable. It gets you sort of started. You don't have to worry about the first time you chip your paint or whatever. But our ultra light is very popular too. It's obviously the lowest end of the aging family. And I personally have a ultra light aged Murphy Lab Gold Top, and I played one gig with it like 3 weeks ago, and I have four chips in the paint in the top of the guitar, and I did not know that until I looked at it later. How did I do that? So I guess it will age itself, and I have a friend who has one out with a prominent big group, and I said, I want to see that in a year after you've had it on the road and come back. I'm sure it will have a new personality. And it'll be all him, right?
That's it. So anyway. Adding to the story of it, it's kind of like it starts off with a certain amount of aging and then it takes its journey. I think the for the people that are watching this at home, this particular guitar is the heavy aged one. And I mean, I think it's a masterpiece. It's beautiful. And to me, even the heavy aged, it's still quite sensible. You haven't gone crazy, crazy, crazy. No, no, no. And I wonder, how far does aging go before it's too far aged?
Right. Well, I say about the ultra heavy, which the belt wear on the back is 3 times the size. That's heavy. And the ultra heavy will be much larger than that. And around the radius of the back, that'll all be worn up. And that comes from my experience with especially artist guitars that we've worked with over the years. It's like the Greeny I'm working on now. You can imagine the condition of Greeny. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Especially after the broken headstock and all the wear. And, it's wonderful to look at that and wonder how some of the things happen over time. I won't say that you can go too far, but at some point, it doesn't benefit the guitar at all. It doesn't make it sound better or even play better. I know that years ago on the very first aging instruments, I was asked, how come they feel and play so much better? And I had no answer really, but I thought later that psychologically the player and consumer felt very relaxed with an aged guitar, because how many times have you leaned your Les Paul against your twin reverb and thought, I hope nothing happens to it? Well, because that's already been done. And if you a few chips here and there and scratches, it's done. You can just play it and enjoy it, not worry about it. I think that's sort of part of it. The coolness of having a really neat guitar, because everybody saw Stevie Ray's guitar, and imagine how long it took for that guitar to take on it. Willie Nelson's guitar with a hole in it. Yeah. He did that himself over a long period of time. Doesn't make the guitar better. I'm sure Willie could care less if the hole's there or not, but he keeps playing that particular guitar. But the feel of one is cool. And so I always say you don't hear the belt buckle wear on the back of an ultra heavy. That has nothing to do with anything except it's an example of what we've seen over the years with heavily played guitars. Sure. We all recognize what all the neck wear and the arm wear. We all know what that is. We aren't doing cigarette burns in the headstock, which I have done, yes. But that's sort of typical. And headstock wear on the end, but that's just generic. Everybody knows where that comes from in the case, even in yep. wear.
Yeah, yeah.
But, I'd like to think that there is decent, nice taste in all our levels of our aging, because I know people will want it. And I invariably have to use the blue jean analogy where once they were able to more authentically make blue jeans look like they were worn and washed and worn and then even start to wear out, that became very, very popular.
It's probably important to impart, or at least you can correct me if I'm wrong about this, but something like this, like, for example, I mean, we have there's a 59 335 and there's a 64 SG. This is a 59 Les Paul. These are the actual examples. If we go back, the historical, the old ones are beyond the means of most musicians to ever get their hands on. They are literally rare yes. museum pieces. So this is the idea of this is more about creating a replica of something that is otherwise, you know, $100,000. This is like as sure. close
yeah.
that most of us can get to these like epic holy grail guitars, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you can imagine the thrill I had when I made a suggestion in 1992 at a meeting. I'd never been to a meeting before, but I was invited to one. And my personal feeling was that the Les Paul reissue was, to vintage people, was like somewhat of a disappointment because of the lack of authenticity in the look and feel. And it was sort of like a, as they say, no-brainer to me, like, you know, if we would fix the neck profile and the headstock and the logo and the carving of the top and the neck pitch, and that turned into another meeting and where they approved, let's try this. And that guitar ended up in Anaheim in 93. And so I was able to show my peers what we were trying to do from inside Gibson. There had been attempts from outside, dealers, consumers over the years, attempt to make a replica of a 59 Les Paul. Well, we do that today still after 20, how many years. And they're so great now that people, professional people who do own authentic vintage, they play new guitars. It is a totally viable alternative to taking your 59 out.
Yeah.
We just made a guitar for a celebrity to take to Europe so he didn't have to take a guitar with a Brazilian fingerboard over there. But he took a replica of his guitar.
Yeah. Yeah.
With an Indian rosewood board. And he played it as an alternative. Well, it wasn't a compromise.
That's it. He's entirely happy to choose that to be what he's playing to thousands of people. So it's doing the same job, right?
Sure.
Awesome.
So anyway, people need to realize, even today, we sort of take for granted. We're in here every day seeing all these cars being built. And I'm much older than most all the employees had in the whole entire company, and especially here at the Custom Shop. And they don't realize what a big leap it was starting in 93 to jump into the design of that instrument, which we, and I have to say thank you to the executives of this company now that support, like the logo, when I said they changed the shape of the G, they could go, no, we're not going to do that. We don't want to pay for it or whatever. They want the guitars to please us and our product development people. And we're all sort of on the same page. We don't have to convince them that it would be cool to do a certain thing. And sometimes they're already ahead of us on it. It's really a great time to be here in the Custom Shop, for sure.
That's brilliant. That's a brilliant thing. You mentioned about the Peter Green, the Greeny guitar. I call it Peter Green. It's Kirk Hammett's now, obviously, but you guys are doing a special edition of that one. That leads me to ask two things. Because I've heard that Kirk has scratched his initials in the KH into the instrument, and I wondered if that's going to appear on this one. And then the next part of that question would be, if you're able to, and maybe you're not able to say, I wonder if there are any other specific artists, like, for example, Pearly Gates or something. Is that something that's maybe in the pipeline for the future?
And your question is when I've had experience with those instruments?
Well, yeah, like with the Peter Green 59 Les Paul, presumably you've had some access with that actual guitar, right?
Oh, sure. Of course. And, yes, I've held Greeny in my hands.
And is that the one that Gibson, that Murphy Lab are doing, is going to be based on that, of course?
Of course.
I
work on them every day. I see them in my sleep now, and there are very, very specific details and elements of signs of wear and time on that guitar you understand. Peter Green did some of it. Gary Moore did some of it. Now Kirk has the guitar, and he's actually playing it. But what I'm executing is those details to give the consumer the look and the spirit of Greeny. And yes, his initials are on there.
Excellent.
That's all I can say about that. But I always tell this story that I lived in Houston, Texas starting in 1969. And the spring of 70, I was 19, and I went to see a new band called ZZ Top in Houston at a very, very small venue. Sat on the floor about 10 feet from the stage where Billy Gibbons walked from behind his Marshall with that Les Paul. That was when I was 19 years old.
Wow.
And heard that band. And in 2009 or 10, I had to fly to Houston, go to the office, and have them get Pearly Gates and bring her to me to hold and to photograph and to take measurements and drawings of the wear and I'm holding that guitar, and then I had to reproduce it. So I say, if you had tapped me on the shoulder when I was 19 and said, someday that guitar, you'll have to reproduce that. I would have said, how is this going to happen? But that's one of the coolest things that has come to me through this whole experience. I could have never predicted that. I could have never predicted that I would hold Peter Green's guitar in my hand, you know? And so I don't take any of it for granted. It's awesome to be part of it. And hopefully it pleases other people. And apparently 50 other people are going to be very happy with their great version of Greeny. I can't tell the exact number that I'm on now, but I'm doing all of the guitars. And yes, I do sort of see them in my sleep. But I try to stop and go, wait a minute, somebody's going to buy this and they're really going to love it. So I try to stay focused on that while I'm doing them. You know, I don't want to compromise any of those. So
certainly not. No,
it's just part of the whole journey with the stuff. I'm just glad people are, like I said, we make a product. I will go back to the beginnings of the aging when some people thought it was frivolous and thought, why do you have to do that to a guitar? I mean, there's been jokes of people pay you to do that to a guitar. Well, it was obvious to me that people would like it and it would be appreciated for feel and look. And honestly, the lab is now totally an upgrade of that whole idea. Wouldn't it be cool if we make it look old? Then, wow, it looks old and it feels old. That's all major benefits and pluses from the whole thing.
Yeah. No, absolutely. That's a really interesting point that you brought up with me there, because it's one of those ones that, as a retailer, we do face that question time and again of people who are not on board with the idea of paying more money to have their brand new guitar beaten up. I kind of understand that, but I think you've just kind of answered this. It's about this kind of like just the feel and the replication of years and years. It isn't a kind of like, it's not trying to pretend to anybody that this isn't a new guitar. It's saying, look at how this feels and look at how this, it's almost like it's like retaining the magic of those early era instruments, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, like I said, when initially people go, how can they feel so good?
Yeah.
We have rolled binding on the edge of the fingerboard. The binding on an old guitar gets smoothed out and takes on the front, just from your hand. But I've seen many, 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 and I can tell you, they started that at the factory. When there's yellow lacquer missing up above the body where you would never play, they took that off to make a nice sort of feel, to give it a head start. Well, we specifically do that now. And like the guitar I have, the Berkeley, the neck just sort of melts in your hand. It's so beautiful. And years ago, I had a reissue guitar from a company, and it drove me crazy that the edge of the neck didn't feel like my real one. It's like, do they not feel that? Can they not reproduce that? Well, we do that, and I feel a very, very important element to not just the Murphy Lab, but the custom shop guitars. They put them in their hand and they just feel really great, because it's just, once again, like blue jeans, take them real stiff, brand new. It takes a long time and a lot of washing and wear before they really fit you and feel good. Well, now you can buy them like that. So we want the guitars to feel great right out of the box. I've said this before, even about the reissue way back. I wanted a blind person who owned a real one to take one of ours and feel it and go, wow, it feels the same way. Because he's never seen flame maple. He's never seen sunburst. He's never seen the logo. All he's done is felt the instrument. And I believe we make that instrument today.
Yeah.
It's not 1959, but we can make it, because there was almost a thought years ago, I've said this too, that you'll never see a 1957 Chevrolet with the fins. You'll never see a modern version of that in production. Mm-hmm. There are way too many restrictions, as we know, right?
Yeah.
Well, I thought about the guitar. Wait a minute, it's made out of wood. we can make it however we want to make it. There are restrictions somewhat on finishes and some other materials and the rosewood fingerboard, of course, but we can actually make a 1959 Les Paul.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
The proof is right here.
There you go.
There it is. Killer. So Tom, thanks very much for talking to us. It's been so fascinating. It's been a joy and I'm absolutely adoring. I don't know where I'm going to find the cash for this one, but I wanted to go home with me. It's probably the best Les Paul I've ever had my hands on.
Awesome.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible. So, and thanks to everybody watching and thank you to Gibson. So this has been Guitar Guitar with Tom Murphy exclusive. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me and thanks for your interest in what I do.
Oh, you're welcome. You're very welcome.